Hi. The other day I saw this patient who was a 35-year-old male patient who came with complaints of both eyes, the defective vision for a long time, for quite a long time, right from his school days. He has best corrected visual acuity of 5/60 on both eyes, which was not improving at all. Then on probing the history, he gave two important things. One was he had a defective night vision. That is, as evening progressed after 6 o'clock or after 7 o'clock in the evening, he had a difficulty in finding objects. That is number one. Number two, he had a difficulty in adapting to dark light after entering from the sun. So he's outside, okay, for some time during his work. When he comes back to home, he's having a difficulty in adapting to the low light conditions. Okay. That was his chief complaints, presenting complaints. No other history of any trauma in the past, no drug intake, no history of vitamin A deficiency. This is an important history to ask. But there was a history of his parents, one of his parents being affected with this similar condition. So there was a family history. There was a long-standing, painless, gradual, non-progressive type of vision defect with nyctalopia or night blindness. So what is this condition? What are we looking at? So by now, most of you would have found what this patient is having. So what I did was I took a basic examination. Slit lamp examination was totally fine as far as the anterior segment is concerned. But when I moved to the posterior segment on appreciating the fundus, I saw this picture. As you can see on this picture, you have three important features. First and foremost, there was a bilateral optic disc paler. Second was, there was this typical black pigments deposited on the fundus. The third, there was attenuation of arterioles or thinning of the arterioles or the vessels you can see on the fundus. So what are we looking for? This is the classic triad of retinitis pigmentosa, which is characterized by A, an optic disc paler, which is a consecutive disc paler, which means it occurs because of the fundus pathology. So it's a consecutive. As a result of retinal pathology, you have a disc paler. And this is a typical waxy disc paler. The second is going to be these black pigments, which are dispersed on the fundus, they're nothing but what we call as the bony corpuscles, which are nothing but the RPE pigments scattered throughout the fundus. And third was the pencil-like thinning of the vessels on the fundus. So let us discuss about this condition. So by now, you know what is the diagnosis. The diagnosis is retinitis pigmentosa. So now we will discuss about RPE in detail, right from scratch till finish. So let's continue with our patient's condition, that is retinitis pigmentosa. RPE is defined as the abiotrophy of neuroepithelium, a very important definition given in Parsons. Neuroepithelium means photoreceptors, rods and cones. To be more specific, rods are going to be commonly affected when compared to cones. It is the most common hereditary fundus dystrophy. In other words, it is the most common inherited disease of retina. RPE belongs to this diverse group of inherited disorders, which is characterized by a progressive, diffuse retinal degenerative diseases. In our patient, the vision was non-progressive, but it is typically classically described as a progressive disease, which affects the rods first, then progresses to affect the cones. The mode of inheritance can be either sporadic or it can be inherited. The sporadic is also called as a simplex or isolated RPE, which is the most common form. Whereas the inherited has three forms, autosomal dominant, autosomal recessive, and X-linked recessive patterns, of which the most common pattern of inheritance is going to be the autosomal dominant, which has the best prognosis. X-linked recessive is going to be the least common, but it is the most severe and it has the worst prognosis because of its severity. The typical picture is going to be this tapetal reflex or this shiny pattern, what you see in the female carriers of X-linked recessive, tapetal reflex of the macula. Okay, now moving on to the pathophysiology. So what is this pathophysiology? Note that RPE is almost always a bilateral disease, which is characterized by genetic mutations of the proteins which are involved in the phototransduction cascade. So one important protein which is involved in the phototransduction pathway is going to be rhodopsin, which is important for night vision. So this rhodopsin gene is getting mutated in RPE. In fact, rhodopsin gene is going to be the very first major RPE gene to be identified. So what happens because of the mutation of rhodopsin? There is going to be a rod cell death. The rod cell dies. How? By apoptosis. So because of the rod cell death, there's going to be two important hallmark symptoms. You know, rod subserves the night vision. So the patient will have the defective night vision, that is nyctalopia. One important differential diagnosis for any patient presenting with defective night vision is going to be vitamin A deficiency. So always ask history of vitamin A deficiency whenever you see a patient with defective night vision. And not just that, the patient will also have a defective dark adaptation. When the patient is going to come from the light to the dark, he will have a difficulty in identifying the objects. The second hallmark symptom is going to be a mid-peripheral visual field loss. As you all know, rods are more concentrated towards the periphery of the fundus. That's why you will have a mid-peripheral visual field loss in RP, which will slowly progress to tunnel vision or ring scotoma. Because initially, there is going to be defective vision from the mid-peripheral region and slowly marches towards the center, just sparing the central fovea or the macular region, the tunnel vision or ring scotoma. The another important differential diagnosis for tunnel vision or ring scotoma is going to be advanced glaucoma. Advanced glaucoma. Very, very important. Now, what happens here is there is going to be this rod cell dysfunctional death, like we just mentioned. Because of this rod cell dysfunction, the associated retinal pigmentary epithelium is also going to get affected. As you all know, you have the rod here, just below that there is going to be the RPE. The RP is going to have multiple melanin pigments. These melanin pigments are going to be released into the retinal layers. And that is what leads to this typical jet black spots, what you call as a bone spicules or bony corpuscles. These bony spicules are seen in the mid-periphery region. And slowly what happens, these bony spicules are going to sheath the veins and arteries, veins more than the arteries, leading on to weakening of the vessels, what you call as the arteriolar attenuation or thinning of the vessels. What is classically described as the pencil-like appearance or the pencil-like thinning. Now, again, because of the RPE losing its melanin pigments, there's going to be discoloration of the RPE leading on to RPE atrophy. This RPE atrophy is going to let the choroidal vessels which are underneath to show more prominently. That is what appears as the tessellated fundus or a tigroid fundus. Tessellated or the typical tigroid fundus, which you often see in high myopia patients as well. Now, coming back, this rod cell dysfunction or death can also lead on to ganglion cell death. Okay, because you all know it's going to be rod and cone, and you have the bipolar cells, which leads to the ganglion cells. So ganglion cells are going to get affected as well. So because of the ganglion cell death, there is going to be consecutive optic atrophy. So this optic atrophy is because of the retinal pathology. It is because of rod cell death. It's because of RPE dysfunction. That's why it's a consecutive optic atrophy, which is characterized by waxy paler of disc. Why the waxy? It's because of the gliosis. The disc appears waxy pale. So like in our patient, the triad of RP is going to be A, pale disc, B, bony corpuscle pigments, and C, arteriolar narrowing or attenuation. So what are the complications you can expect in RP? As far as macula is concerned, it can go for an atrophy, there can be an epiretinal membrane, there can be a cystoid macular edema, as you can see in this picture. There's a cystoid macular edema, small honeycomb cyst-like pattern you can note on OCT on fundus picture as well. And on the lens, it can lead to complicated cataract, it can lead to posterior subcapsular cataract and cortical cataract. Now these complications will be one of the very important reasons for defective vision in a patient with RP. Now moving on to very important associations of retinitis pigmentosa. The ocular associations are going to be myopia, high myopia patients, microphthalmos, keratoconus, primary open angle glaucoma, peripheral vitreous detachments, and optic disc drusen. More important from an exam perspective is going to be the systemic associations, or what you call as the syndromic retinitis pigmentosa. One important syndrome is going to be Lawrence Moon Bardet Biedl syndrome, which is characterized by polydactyly and mental retardation. I know it's a long name, but please remember. Cocaine syndrome, Refsum's disease because of the phytanic acid accumulation. Usher's syndrome, another important syndrome which is characterized by hearing loss. In fact, books say it is the most common type of syndromic RP. Remember, Usher's hearing loss. Ush means the patient is not able to hear. Halgren's disease, A-beta lipoproteinemia, also called as Basson-Konsweg syndrome, which is characterized by acanthocytes in blood film. One more ophthalmic relevant syndrome is Kearns-Sayre syndrome, which is having the mitochondrial inheritance. It is characterized by chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia, which leads to ptosis bilaterally. Okay. Now moving on to what is atypical RP. Atypical RP includes a syndromic RP. So you should write all these syndromes here as well. Syndromic RP. What are the other atypical RPs? Cone rod dystrophy, here where the cones are involved first. If cones are going to be affected first, the central vision goes first. The color vision also gets reduced first. RP sinipigmento. Sinipigmento means there are no pigments. retinitis punctata albicans, which is characterized by white dots on fundus instead of black. That is albicans. Albino means white. So white dots will be seen. Leber congenital amaurosis, another important atypical retinitis pigmentosa. It is the most common genetic cause of defective vision in children. Always, whenever you see a patient with a RP unilaterally, always rule out pseudo retinitis pigmentosa conditions like syphilis and rubella. These are acquired diseases in children. Now, let us look at some pictures. This is the typical ptosis what you see in the Kearns-Sayre syndrome, which is characterized by chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia. This is the typical acanthocytes or spine-like pattern of the cells. Acanthocytes. And this is the typical ichthyosis or dry skin, what you see in the Refsum's disease because of accumulation of phytanic acid. And this is the polydactyly, what you see in the Varadit-Badl syndrome. This is RP sinipigmento, where there are no pigments, a very difficult to diagnose condition because you don't see the pigments there at all. This is retinitis punctata albicans, which is characterized by multiple white dots. One close differential diagnosis is going to be vitamin A deficiency, which can lead to the xerophthalmic fundus. The xerophthalmic fundus also will have a typical white lesions, and this xerophthalmic fundus is called as Uemura's fundus. Uemura fundus, very important. Now moving on to the syndromic RPs, Lawrence Moon Varadit-Badl syndrome. Important thing is the patient will be having loss of secondary sexual characters. There will be no mustache, there will be hypogonadism, the patient will have a truncal obesity, and importantly the patient will have a polydactyly along with short stubby fingers. Cocaine syndrome is characterized by sparse hand adipose tissue atrophy. But more important is going to be the Leber congenital amaurosis, which is characterized by constant rubbing of eyes. The baby or the child will keep on rubbing the eyes because they can't see. And because of this constant rubbing, it's going to be an optic fat atrophy leading on to enophthalmos. This is what you call as the oculodigital sign. Now moving on to the investigations of retinitis pigmentosa. Three important investigations. First is you should do an electroretinogram, an ERG, a visual field analysis, OCT or optical coherence tomography. An ERG should be a full field ERG where the typical response will be initially there will be reduced scotopic rod and combined response. Later there will be reduced photopic response. And finally, the most important is going to be an extinguished ERG pattern will be observed. So initially the rod is going to be affected. So the scotopic response is going to be affected. Then the cones, the photopic, finally both rods and cones are going to be affected, leading on to an extinguished ERG. One important thing to note is that RP, there will be a reduced A wave of ERG, whereas in a congenital stationary night blindness, which is a very similar RP like fundus or retinal degeneration, which is a rather stationary or non-progressive. Okay, here you will have a reduced B wave. So this is an important differential between both RP and CSNB. As far as visual field is concerned, you will have a mid-peripheral scotoma, finally leading on to the ring scotoma or tunnel vision. So this is going to be the typical tunnel vision, where only the central part the patient will be able to see. There's a peripheral tunnel-like deficiency of vision is going to be happening. So ring scotoma or tunnel vision. This is the typical ERG response noted. Here you can see both the rod as well as the combined responses are diminished. Moving on to the treatment aspect of RP. See, we all know that there is no proven treatment for retinitis pigmentosa. So it's very often we tell the patients that, you know, this is what you can have. This is all the vision you have. We can't do anything about it. But it is important to tell the patient that there is still some scope. We can still use the existing vision optimally to give you the best possible results. So low vision aids play a very huge role in making the patients feel satisfied and live a happier life. And also avoid retinotoxic drugs and ask the patient to wear sunglasses to avoid any phototoxicity. As far as medical treatment is concerned, high dose of vitamin A was prescribed or was recommended some time back, but it is not being done now because of the risk of lung cancer and is potentially hepatotoxic. Still, some physicians give lutein and zeaxanthin, all these macronutrients people give. One important thing you should know is that whenever you see a patient in retinitis pigmentosa with cystoid macular edema, give the patient topical or oral carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. So the drug of choice for CME in retinitis pigmentosa is going to be a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. And as always, because of the high risk of cataracts associated with RP, it is good to do a cataract extraction, but note that there is an increased risk of post-op inflammation as well. So this is to do with the conventional treatment options what we have currently. But one important question which they might ask you in exams is going to be the recent advances in the treatment of RP. The recent advances can be of three types. One, there can be gene therapy at a molecular level, cell therapy where they transplant the retinal progenitor cells into the affected retina. So gene therapy and cell therapy, but the most important is going to be the artificial retina or the bionic eye. A very, very important question people will ask in exams. Hence, the artificial retina or the bionic eye helps in transmitting the light directly to the brain, bypassing the diseased retina. It can be of three types depending upon where the device is placed. It can be an epiretinal, subretinal or supracoroidal devices. The epiretinal devices are going to be Argus 2, which is the second generation epiretinal microelectrode array retinal prosthesis. It is the very first FDA approved treatment for RP. The second is going to be Epiret 3. The third is going to be Iris or Intelligent Retinal Implant System. So these three are going to be the epiretinal devices. The subretinal devices are Retinal Implant Alpha IMS and Boston Retinal Implant. The one supracoroidal implant, what you have to remember, is going to be the BVA or Bionic Vision Australia Retinal Prosthesis Implant. So here are some of the pictures showing the same. This is the Argus 2 Retinal Prosthesis System. So you can see clearly, this is the retinal implant being placed on the retina, or this is the epiretinal implant. And this is the in-situ picture from the fundus. This is going to be the Iris 2 and this is going to be the Epiret 3. So this is going to be the Retina Implant Alpha AMS system, and this is the BVA, Bionic Vision Australia, supracoroidal implant, which has two components. You have an epiretinal component as well as it has a supracoroidal component. So let's summarize. As far as RP is concerned, know the rule of three. There are three symptoms: defective night vision, delay in dark adaptation, and visual field defects. The three important symptoms. Three signs are going to be the classic triad: the optic disc pallor, bony spicules, and arteriolar attenuation. The three investigations, what we should do is then do an electrotinogram, visual field analysis, and OCT to rule out CME or cistern macular edema. The three treatment options currently tried are LVA, very, very important, low vision aids, medical treatment, surgery for cataracts. In medical treatment, remember the drug of choice, acetazolamide or carbonic anhydrase inhibitors for cistern macular edema. The three recent treatment advances are cell therapy, gene therapy, and the more important bionic eye or the retinal prosthesis or artificial retina, which can be again placed in three different locations: epiretinal, subretinal, and supracoroidal. Know only one name, that is Argus 2. Very, very important. So that ends with RP. Thanks for listening. Cheers. Bye-bye.